Yeah, that's right. Stay off my lawn.
Oh, hey, hello, Justin here. Sorry, I was just arguing with my neighbor. Again. Every time he cuts his grass, he comes into my backyard. And he's always fishing in my pond. At least, I think it's my pond. You know, now that I think about it, I'm not totally sure where my property ends and his begins. We don't really have a border. You may remember that borders are official lines recognized by laws or agreements that separate political regions. But why are borders so important in our world? Let's find out. As we do, hopefully we'll find a compromise to my backyard border dispute.
Hey, hey buddy, those are my roses.
It's necessary for my neighbor and I to establish a border? What's the purpose of borders anyway? Well, check out these maps. In our previous unit, we studied this physical map, which shows Earth's natural environment. What's different about this map? This one shows us the borders that divide our world into states. It's a political map. But can these borders actually be seen in the real world? Some political borders are demarcated, meaning they are physically marked by signs, fences, or other visible identifiers. Some borders are even determined by natural boundaries, which are physical features like mountains or rivers that divide areas, regions, or countries. While these borders can be physically seen, most borders are delimited, meaning they aren't actually visible on the Earth's landscape. So, if most borders are just lines on maps, what's the point of them? Well, think back to the dispute with my neighbor. Establishing a clear border would allow us to make rules and decisions about our properties without anyone else telling us what to do. You may remember that when states have this power, it's called sovereignty. Laws enforced within U.S. borders, for example, don't apply within Mexico's borders, and vice versa. Borders also determine a state's access to and control over resources. Governments can decide how to use and protect resources like water, minerals, and forests within its borders. For example, borders in Western Asia determine which states have control over the rich oil fields of the region. Borders can significantly impact a state's economy. Most importantly, borders help maintain peaceful relationships between states. They define where one ends and another begins, limiting conflicts between neighbors. Think about all of these reasons for political borders. What do you think the world would be like without them? After going through it, yeah, I think it's definitely worthwhile for my neighbor and I to establish a border. So far, we've learned that borders are super important. But check out these historical maps. The political borders of our world have changed so much over time. History is full of nations and states disputing territory. Sometimes it leads to conflict. One major reason borders change is because of political agreements signed to resolve these conflicts. For example, treaties signed after World War I completely changed the map of Europe. But why would a country want to change its borders? Well, let's look closer at my backyard. Check out this map of our properties. Remember, we both want access to this fishing pond. So, what if you just drew a straight line through the pond like this? Borders that are drawn as straight lines, or more specifically, borders that are based on latitude or longitude lines, are called geometric borders. They're often used in political agreements to prevent conflicts, like this border between the US and Canada. Would this geometric border resolve our conflict? Well, we'd both have access to the pond. But there's another issue. These red roses are mine, and the yellow sunflowers are his. This border would split our flowers apart, and I want all of my roses on my property. You know, these flowers kind of remind me of cultural boundaries, which are geographic areas where two different ethnic, linguistic, or religious groups intersect. Imagine if our flowers were two different cultural groups. And instead of being split into two gardens, imagine if they were split across two countries. The cultural groups would likely want to redraw borders so they could all be together under one government. Throughout history, just like in my backyard, states have wanted to change their borders both to control resources, like our pond, and to unify cultural groups, kind of like my flowers. My neighbor and I will need to consider these factors. And throughout history, these factors have been even more critical for governments to consider, changing the world's political borders over time. So far, we've learned that borders are super dynamic, changing over time due to cultural, economic, and political factors. Think back to why that geometric border wouldn't work in my backyard. And check out this map of Namibia. Why do you think so many countries, like Namibia, are so oddly shaped? Well, this long, narrow region, the Caprivi Strip, was added to Namibia's territory to increase its access to the Zambezi River, giving it a super interesting shape. You see, most states don't choose their shapes. Instead, the shape of a state tells a story about its history, politics, culture, and economy. Over time, most states' borders have formed into one or more of these shapes: compact, prorupted, elongated, fragmented, or perforated. Looking at these examples, can you predict any advantages or disadvantages of a country's shape? If you couldn't think of any, no worries. Let's look closer at each shape. Compact states, like Poland, are kind of shaped like circles. Prorupted states are mostly compact, but they have a tail that extends out, like Namibia. And elongated states are long and narrow, like Chile. Let's consider the benefits of these shapes. Here's a hint: one is easy to defend, and the others offer more resources. Can you guess which is which? In compact states, the capitals are usually centrally located, making them much easier to defend. However, compact states are often smaller, so their resources can be limited. Now look at Namibia and Chile. Their shapes give them access to more resources. Namibia's tail portion reaches the Zambezi River, and Chile's elongated shape gives it an extensive coastline. However, elongated states and the tail portion of prorupted states can sometimes be hard to defend. It can also be difficult to maintain unity and to manage transportation and communication in these shapes. Now look at Azerbaijan, a fragmented state. What do you notice? This part of the country is totally disconnected. This piece is called an exclave, a fragment or piece of a country that is separated from the rest. Finally, check out South Africa, a perforated state. Notice anything interesting? This is Lesotho, an independent state that just happens to be in South Africa. Lesotho's an enclave, a state or foreign territory that's completely surrounded by another country. Think back to how borders evolve. Why do you think enclaves and exclaves develop? Well, let's go back to my backyard. What if I agreed to draw a border around this group of sunflowers and give my neighbor control of it? His property would be fragmented, and he'd own this exclave of sunflowers. My property would therefore be perforated, because this would be considered an enclave in my backyard. Exclaves develop when a nation has political, cultural, or economic needs in a region that is separate from its main territory. And enclaves develop when a region has unique needs that are different from the surrounding state, leading to it wanting sovereignty. Hey, with those borders, we'll both have access to the ponds and all of our own flowers. We may have settled this conflict. Unless my neighbor starts taking all the fish from that pond or bringing his rusty lawnmower over here to access his sunflower exclave, then we might have to start again. Today, we've seen how complex and dynamic borders can be. Addressing my backyard border conflict certainly wasn't easy, but now that we understand how culture, economics, and politics influence borders, and in turn, how borders impact states, I think we're one step closer to being expert political geographers. We'll see you in our next geography adventure. Until then, keep exploring.